doctor, repeatedly asking for help. My boy Michael went into the back bedroom, put a shotgun under his chin, and took his life. There's nothing, there's no pain like it in this world. There's nothing that can compare to the pain of holding your son while he's taking his last breath.
Avi and his wife Julie, who was also here today, lost their son Michael 3 years ago on this very day as a result of addiction to prescription painkillers. Avi has worked very closely with Senator Young, Senator Gallivan, myself, Senator Grisani, and Senator Ranzenhofer from Western New York to pass I-STOP legislation, but that was only the first step. And Avi, we know you have given the rest of your life to this particular challenge, and we thank you very much for being here.
Senator Maziarz is listening and responding to the spike in death and addiction of heroin. Welcome to Your Voice. I'm Julia Locandy.
Hi, Julia. How are you?
Good. How are you today?
Very good. That was a very good opening there. That was a hearing that we did in Cattaraugus County with Senator Phil Boyle and his committee on the epidemic of heroin in New York State and everywhere, actually.
Mm-hmm. My heart is racing. Just hearing that, it's kind of hard to shake off.
Avi Israel is a true advocate. He is just an unbelievable person. Avi lost his son to drug addiction. His son was ill, went to a doctor, was prescribed opioids, oxycodone, oxycontin, and became addicted to them and couldn't break that addiction. And as Avi said, eventually took his own life. And Avi has basically retired from his job and is trying desperately to make sure that no other parent goes through what he's going through. And at that hearing, Senator Boyle heard from, it was very good if you noticed the way that it was set up. They had not just the legislators there at the table, but also family members, individuals who directly affected, people who've been addicted to heroin. They had healthcare providers there, addiction treatment individuals, law enforcement people, and of course, Senator Young, Senator Gallivan, Senator Boyle, and myself, and also some local elected officials that were there. Senator Boyle has introduced a series of 25 bills that I believe we're going to be taking up actually this week to address this problem. I think that as a parent, Avi is in support of all of them. There's just a myriad of different things that we have to do. It's not just about law enforcement. Obviously, that's very important, but it's also about a treatment, for individuals. That's one of the issues that Avi had with his son. He was unable to get the proper treatment, and his son, unfortunately, saw there was just no way out for him other than to take his own life.
So this forum was with the Seneca Nation of Indians?
It was on the Cattaraugus Seneca Nation at their very beautiful community center. Senator Boyle has held 18 of these forums throughout the state of New York, so we've held them everywhere. As a result of what people have said there, and again, all of them were pretty much segmented the same, with individuals that have been affected by drug addiction, by people who treat drug addiction, school groups. I missed them earlier today. I should have said there were several superintendents there, building principals and students, and then law enforcement people. Senator Boyle, working with his task force, has come up with this 25 different pieces of legislation. And he sort of broke it up into 25 different pieces of legislation so that this is a democratic process, and we have to go through the Assembly and the Senate. And I know that Senator Boyle is negotiating with the Assembly. We think we can get, some meaningful legislation passed. One of the bills that I'm very interested in, and that Avi Israel actually helped my office draft, is about continuing education for doctors. We know that many of the professions in the state of New York are required to take so many credits on an annual basis for continuing education to become aware of changes in, you know, in laws, to become aware of changes in technology and everything. And doctors have to do that too. And one of the requirements would be that some segment of that continuing education be about opioid addiction, painkillers, and things like that. So then there's another aspect about police officers being armed with a drug that would negate the immediate heroin effect on an individual. We've seen that this has saved lives across the state of New York. Most police departments, a lot of the first responders are now having this, because this is an issue. And you saw last week there was Senator Boyle had a press conference here, and the sheriff of Sullivan County, who was very open. I thought Sullivan County, I think, is kind of a small a county, and he indicated that his own daughter is addicted to heroin. So it's really everywhere. It's in remote areas. Cattaraugus County is a predominantly farming community. It's a Native American reservation. It's not just an urban problem. I think one of the issues, and I thought the law enforcement people did a very good job, and the school representatives that were there, the education representatives that were there, did a very good job of explaining how the perception is that this is an urban problem. You know, that it's New York City, it's Rochester, it's Buffalo, you know, and it's not. It is truly everywhere.
Yeah, you brought up the school representation, and that's a very important part of this measure too.
It is.
Because prevention.
It is. And one of the things that some of the students there said, and I thought they made an excellent point, first of all, you know, when you get students that are willing to appear at a panel like that, is a good step to begin with. But, you know, they talked about, peer-to-peer education forums, you know, that, you know, they have, if an adult comes in the room, you know, or particularly, let's say, a uniformed law enforcement officer or something like that, I think the effect on it is not going to be as much as it is on a peer-to-peer basis. Mm-hmm. And, you know, unfortunately, there's just a lot of people out there that are affected by this and that can do this. There was one young person there who was addicted to heroin, has beat that addiction. You know, she said it's a struggle on a daily basis, but it's one that, you know, she has seen the positives of it. And, you know, it was a very moving forum, I'd have to say. And I'll tell you, it was scheduled to last for 4 hours, and it lasted every minute of those 4 hours. Mm.
It's very eye-opening.
Yes.
So the Senate is going to take up these bills this
yes.
week?
Yes. The Senate is going to take up Senator Boyle's 25 bills this week. We are hoping that the Assembly, I'm certain, also has a package of bills. Senator Boyle is working very hard to reconcile with the Assembly. The governor is very much aware of this problem, and I'm certain if there's anything that we are going to see done in the remaining however many days we have here, 8 days, I would think something along these lines, because there's just too much. There's a lot of pressure on the legislature, but there's a realization among the legislators that this is a huge problem out there that we have to address.
Yes. So access to health care for rural areas is
yes.
really self-explanatory. Tell us about the New Fane Hospital. Do you have an update
yes.
there?
I do. I've continued to meet. New Fane is part of Eastern Niagara Health Systems. There are two hospitals, the one located in Lockport, one located in New Fane. New Fane is, ironically, coincidentally, happens to be the town that I live in. When my kids were younger and it seemed like they were getting sick or, you know, needing stitches every other week, we always went to New Fane Hospital and got great treatment there, by the way. But obviously with healthcare today being challenged all over the place, you know, with the Affordable Care Act, with, you know, the myriad of options that people have today to access healthcare with urgent care centers and in inter-office procedures, that hospitals are stretched. And New Fane is a great hospital, serves a very large community, geographically large community. It's, I think that there are five fire companies whose first, I don't know what they call it, but their first option is to go to the emergency room at New Fane Hospital. So I met with the fire chiefs. They feel very strongly about keeping it open, and they're right. I've met with employees. I did meet with the board of I met with individual board of directors, and really this is a question that's going to come down to the local board of directors. I think that there are 14 of them, and I've talked to most of them already, and I have tried to intercede with the New York State Department of Health. This is not being driven by Albany or by the state. I think, in my estimation, one of the things that may be a positive thing is if Newfane and Eastern Niagara were to partner with one of the, what we call one of the giant systems that we have in Western New York, either the Catholic system or Kaleida system, and we're working on that too.
So tell us about the hazardous waste drop-off.
Oh, yes, this Saturday in the city of Niagara Falls, we had our second of four hazardous waste drop-off days. These are days where residents can come and drop off their old paint that they have around the house, or thinner, or, varnish, stuff like that. I think my wife doesn't, we have cans of paint from like three shades of colors that we've had, She never throws out any paint because you never know you're going to need one drop. When you repaint the whole room, you can get rid of the old stuff. But they're very popular because people, I think, today are, I'll tell you, when it comes to our education system, we talk about recycling and not throwing dangerous things like back to our previous conversation about unused drugs down the toilet anymore. There's places to drop them off now, and they're disposed of in an environmentally friendly way. Well, this is old cans of insecticide and as I said, paints, thinners. What we call household hazardous waste stuff. Don't throw it in your garbage. Don't dump it out in the woods. You can come to one of these drop-off days. Now, the one problem that we had, and this is a good problem to have, we had, I think, 275 slots where people would go online and make an appointment to come in. And the 275 slots filled up in just a matter of a few days. Now, we were able to take some drive-ups. We tried to get them in as much as we could. I don't think we turned back anybody. I wasn't there for the whole thing, but I don't think we turned away anyone. Now we're doing another one in the city of Lockport. That's coming up in a couple of weeks. And our slots for that one are almost all full. So I think we're going to try to add some more slots or maybe do a couple more in the county over the summer, during maybe the late summer, early fall sometime. They're very popular, and we were kind of overwhelmed with the turnout, to be honest with you.
Is there a list of items that they can drop off?
There is a list of items. If you go to recyclemywaste.com or the Niagara County Refuse Disposal District website, the Niagara County website, their environmental management team, Dawn Tim, it's all the information is on there.
You brought up the prescription drugs. One of the 25 bills is for the proper and timely disposal
of
narcotics.
And that's one of the things that we talked about at the forum was the proper disposal of narcotics. Most police, not all, but most police departments, like the City of Lockport Police Department, Niagara County Sheriff's Department, in my district, anyway, the ones that I'm most familiar with, City of Niagara Falls Police Department, they all have drop boxes at their police station. Go to the City of Lockport. There's a drop box right there. Take your prescriptions. Don't flush them. There's an environmentally safe way of getting rid of them. And particularly, I think, for older people, your grandkids are curious, and they're going to go in your medicine cabinet. And, you don't want that. So go through your prescriptions, get rid of them, and there's a safe, easy way and free way to do it, and that's take them down to your local police department. They'll take them off your hands.
Great. Thank you so much for being with us,
okay,
Senator.
Okay, Julia. Thank you.
Thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator George Maziarz. For additional information on what we discussed today, maziarz.nysenate.gov.